everybody, and welcome to Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. I'm your host, Boyd Pierce, and before I tell you about the matches, let me remind you, I have just about 3 weeks left to get those dream match letters into us. Pick out the match that you'd like to see made and send it to the television station in which you're viewing. They'll take them all and forward them on to us. The match that receives the most votes then will be held right here on television. Remember, Dusty Rhodes will be here in that period of time, Andre the Giant, Ted DiBiase, and of course the suspension of the Samoan Warriors off in Sika will be up. Whether they'll be there, you have an opportunity. Any match that you want to see, send it to the television station in which you're viewing. This week, you'll see Mike George in the ring against Bob Roop. The Polish Prince, Ed Wiskowski, is here. Also here, the new Louisiana heavyweight title holder, the Junkyard Dog, who defeated the Great Kabuki in New Orleans on December the 7th. So a lot of great action coming up. And our guest commentator this week, the North American heavyweight champion, Ted DiBiase. Now, Ted, last week, the weapon that you've used many times successfully here on television, the figure four, was turned against you, and a lesser conditioned athlete would surely have submitted. You was able to hold on. It took a lot of grit and determination not to submit, and it looks like Paul Orndorff has really been listening and working with Bob Roop on something like the figure four.
Well, Reacher, anytime you have a hold that's effective as a figure four leg lock and that has been as successful for me as it has been, your opponents are going to be watching you, and they're going to try to find a counter for the hold. And obviously, like you said, Paul Orndorff and Bob Roop have put their heads together, and they come up with a counter. And I'll have to say that last week when we went off there, I was in excruciating pain. My leg was in severe pain, but to give up to the likes of Paul Orndorff, I don't think that I'd rather him break my leg than submit to the man. And I'm just going to have to come up with something for him.
Tremendous spirit, tremendous courage. Right now we have the opening event in the ring. Let's go to Reacher Bowden for the introduction.
And this event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 240 pounds from Los Angeles, California, Tom Renesto Jr. In the blue corner at 232 pounds from Tampa, Florida, Brian Blair.
The opening event announcement, getting his black jacket on the far side, Tom Renesto Jr., the colorful purple vest coming off now of Brian Blair. Alfred Neely, the referee, calls for the bell. Brian Blair, former football star for the University of Louisville. And our guest commentator, Ted DiBiase, with that professional insight, and he'll be breaking it down.
You know, boy, I've watched this Brian Blair before in the past. The boy is fastly building himself a reputation in professional wrestling. He's a fine athlete. He's from Florida, I understand, and he's trained down under there, you know, and watched many great professionals, Jack Briscoe, Jerry Briscoe, Eddie Graham. And the man has built a fine reputation for himself. He's quick, he's very agile, and I think he's an up-and-coming star. Into a fire and carry, he's got that alarm.
Brian Blair on the arm of Tom Renesto Jr. in just the opening event on a great card this week. You want to stay with us all the way? We'll see the return of the muscular, precious Paul Ellering, who's been out with an injury for the past 6 months. He'll be back. The Junkyard Dog, the new Louisiana heavyweight champion. Paul Orndorff and Bob Orton Jr. will join forces in tag team action. A big battle, Mike George versus Bob Roop. As Brian Blair moved it into a hammerlock now behind Tom Renesto Jr.
Blair working on that arm of Tom Renesto, trying to weaken it. Elbow by Renesto. Body tackle. Right back on that arm. Very quick, very smart move on Blair's part. Continues to put pressure on that arm, Boyd, which is a sign of a very smart professional. You find a weakness, find a weak point, and stay after it.
Also this week, we'll see General Skandar Akbar, who's been singing his praises to the high heaven of his new man, the Iron Sheik. So we'll see them in action. Ed Wiskowski, the Polish Prince. Action-packed battle in every match, so you want to stay with us all the way through. This is just the opening event as Brian Blair continues to force the pressure on Big Tom Renesto Jr.
Never!
Ed, I know you'll receive a lot of votes from the fans. In fact, you've already received a lot of them. Well, this dream match coming up the first week in January, as the fans have sent to their television station, wherever they're viewing this on the Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. They'll all being forwarded to us here for the tally. And I know your name has come up on many of them in the dream match. One of the most popular stars we've ever had, and proud to be wearing that North American Heavyweight Champion. As he drops the shoulder, Brian Blair leapfrogging now across Tom Ernesto Jr.
Catching with another big arm drag right back to the arm, Boyd. Brian staying on that arm. Can weaken that arm and wear the man's arm down enough, apply enough pressure to that arm, maybe get a submission. Ernesto into the hair, looking for the shortcuts, using the fist on Blair.
Being warned by Alfred Neely, the referee, keep those fists open.
Backdrop. Blair kicks out.
Signifying the two count.
With a lot of fire. Got him mustered up now. Big backdrop on Blair. Up on that second rope. Big elbow off that top rope. That had to hurt. This could be the fall here. Takes a two count. Looks like he's going for that overhead suplex. Blair going for that figure four leg lock. He's applied the figure four leg lock. He's got the figure four on Ernesto. This should be it, Boyd. That's the fall. You can obviously see, Boyd, that the figure four leg lock is a very effective hold. I'm sure Brian, coming from where he is and studying under the people that he studied, has watched Jack and Gerald Briscoe use that hold, studied Eddie Graham, and use it quite effectively to beat
Tom
Ernesto.
We'll be right back with more action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
As you well know, for the past 6 months, precious Paul Ellering has been recuperating from a very serious injury. But, Paul, it seems that you're back now and in better shape than ever and raring to go.
I can't believe it myself. Precious Paul, the living doll, the master of disaster, the master blaster. From 8 to 80, Precious drives him crazy. And I'm back, RB. Better and bigger than ever. Precious Paul's back. And back to stay, not back to play. Precious Paul's got a lot of lovely ladies out there, and he's got one main squeeze in mind. Precious Paul understands there's $1,000 floating out here in the stratosphere. Can you dig it? Stratosphere. There's 1,000 big ones, and I got one big main squeeze in line, and she says, Precious Paul, I like 1,000 clamoroos. I know you give it away every day, and I say, lovely lady, it's so great to be great. Precious Paul loves the land of the free and the home of the footlong hot dog. Can you dig it, footlong hot dog?
Absolutely.
Now, Precious Paul wants to put out a challenge. Can you dig it? A challenge. I want to challenge the Iron Geek. I mean, the Iron Sheik. You know, the blender brain. I want to challenge him to his clubs. Can you dig it? Clubs.
I can, and it's been tried before.
I know it's been tried before, but this time you're dealing with a man. You know, a lot of men have gone by the wayside. And a lovely lady said to me, Precious Paul, I wouldn't go out with you if you were the last man on earth. I said, but lovely lady, I'm the only man on earth. The challenge stands, and Precious Paul will not fail because I back up from no man. And if he's a man, he'll do the same.
Let's well, you've heard the challenge, and you can well see that Precious Paul Ellering is ready to go. This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. I love it. And in the red corner at 238 pounds from Melrose, Minnesota, there he is, precious Paul Ellering.
Oh, yeah, it's me.
And in the blue corner at 228 pounds, Don Serrano.
Precious Paul Ellering now taking off that jacket and revealing those flowing muscles. The muscular precious Paul Ellering returned. He'd been out with injury for the past 6 months against Don Serrano in the blue.
Well, Boyd, precious Paul Ellering, without a doubt, a very colorful individual. I have to say in my own opinion that he seems to be a little strange, but you can't discredit the man. He's obviously, by looking at him, a very tremendous athlete, very muscular athlete, very well built, very strong individual, and has issued the challenge to the Iron Sheik to try the Persian clubs. And I understand that Paul Ellering suffered a severe injury and has been out of wrestling for some 6 months, and it shows a great amount of determination and willpower, regardless of what you think of him, for him to fight back off of this injury that he sustained and come back to wrestling.
And not being able to wrestle means he has no money coming in, so that $1,000 really would loom large in his eyes. And as he flexed that muscle a while ago when he first made his appearance, you can see it really determined, Ted. So the Iron Sheik and General Skandar Akbar, here's a man that's really after that money.
And from the looks of him, Boyd, from his appearance, he looks like he might be a man. If he's going to accept that challenge, he might be the man to take the man's money. Don Serrano with a quick move there. Small package. Precious Paul's out. Caught him with a big knee.
He was waiting for Serrano to come off the ropes. Caught him right to the midsection.
Big elbow. A big elbow to the chest of John Serrano. Having been off 6 months, Boyd, from listening to him, it didn't seem to be to put much of a cramp in the man's lifestyle. Very flamboyant, obviously. And from
moving
the looks
well,
of it, very determined.
Well, in the ring for being off that long. And of course, nothing wrong with his vocal cords, as you heard the challenge being issued. His precious
that could be
ball
it right
entering.
There. He's ended many a match with that. That's it, Boyd.
1, 2, 3, and Precious Paul returns to a triumphant victory over Don Serrano. We'll be back. The Louisiana Heavyweight Champion Junkyard Dog in action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 228 pounds from San Diego, California, Mike Boyer. And at 270 pounds from Tennessee, the brand new Louisiana heavyweight champion, the Junkyard Dog.
Your next event, Mike Boyer returning to the Mid-South area against a man who come in at the familiar sound of his music, only this time he was wearing around his waist the Louisiana heavyweight championship belt that he won in New Orleans on December the 7th from Playboy Gary Hart's Great Kabuki. Ted?
You know, boy, I'd like to take this opportunity to congratulate the Junkyard Dog. Certainly no more hot and heavy in that ring. Boy, they got fired up right away. Dog certainly not one to back down from anybody. Boy, I wanted to take it to him, and the dog took it right back to him. Big shot right to the face. Ooh, that had to hurt. Like I was saying, boy, I'd like to congratulate the Junkyard Dog. Certainly no one more deserving than the dog to win that Louisiana heavyweight title, defeating the great opponent, the Great Kabuki.
Tremendous headbutt sends Mike Boyer almost all the way out of the ring.
You know, we were talking earlier about men with determination and desire. You know, everyone knows that the dog fought off a very severe injury at one time to come back. And you look at him standing there today, the man is one fine athlete and one fine person. Proud to say that he's my friend.
A fine person represents so many fine people in this Mid-South area. They've come to know him, to love him, to support him. And the apex came when he gained that Louisiana Heavyweight Championship.
Applying the pressure to Mike Boyer's arm. Tell you what, that dog puts them big arms around you. Boy, that's like having a vice grip on you. Whatever the smart move. Dog set out, right back on him.
Fast action on the part of both men, send them into the rope.
Dog firing back.
You don't want to stand toe-to-toe and slug with him, Ned.
No, you certainly don't. Here comes that big front boy. That had to level him. There he goes. Oh, that's it, boy. It's got to be all over now. One, two, three. That's it.
The big thump gains a victory for Louisiana heavyweight title holder Junkyard Dog, and we'll be back after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
And now it's tag team action for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 238 pounds, the Mississippi heavyweight champion, Bob Orton Jr. And his partner at 248 pounds, former North American heavyweight champion, Paul Orndorff.
He's stole my belt.
And in the opposite corner at 265 pounds, the man known only as the Monk. And his partner at 235 pounds, Carlos Zapata.
Paul Orndorff and Bob Orton Jr. teaming up against the Monk and Carlos Zapata. Zapata and Paul Orndorff in the ring now, representing their respective teams. Ted Paul Ellering a few moments ago not only looked in terrific shape, but you'll have to recall he was out of action 6 months. That means 180 days that he was there thinking, and might as well say in captivity for all purposes. That's nothing as he compares it to the 440 days of the Iranian, so he's really vengeance, and we're gonna have that challenge that was made later on this week, so the fans will be able to see it. Paul Ellering with the Persian clubs. And remember, the Iron Sheik must do twice as many as Paul Ellering or lose $1,000.
That's exactly right, and I'm very anxious to see this. The Sheik's been out here several times, you know, always yelling about competition, issued this challenge now for a long time, looking for somebody to come along and take it. Paul Ellering's hungry. He's looking to you know, prove himself again in the Mid-South, and would do it in high fashion should he take this test of the Iron Sheik's and defeat him, take his money.
Bob Orton's been in and now he's out again. Paul Orndorff against Carlos Zapata as tag team action continues at a hot and heavy pace.
Well, boy, I'd also like to make mention of the Junkyard Dog now being the Louisiana heavyweight champion and having the holder of the Mid-South Tag Team Champion. This is like double duty for the Junkyard Dog. It focuses a lot of attention on him, you know, being the North American heavyweight champion and feeling the pressure that that puts on you. I know it's a double load on the Junkyard Dog, but he's a big man, and I think that he can handle it.
He's a big thump, can handle it, as Bob Orton continues the punishment on Carlos Zapata.
This team of Paul Orndorff and Bob Orton Jr., I have to say, without a doubt, has become a very formidable team.
Bob Orton with the right cross, as vainly you saw Zapata trying to reach the Monk, but he couldn't make it.
So far, Orndorff and Orton showing complete control in this match.
Paul Orndorff in now legally.
Whether you like them or not, legally or illegally, they show an awful lot of teamwork.
Zapata turning things around momentarily. but it didn't last very long. There you see the outcast man of the monk. Once again, Arndorf refused to let him tag. While he reaches out, it's Bob Orton Jr. now, keeping a fresh partner in at all times where they're not allowing Zapata and the monk to tag in and out.
I might add also with the board that now that I know Paul Orndorf has been working on a counter for the figure four, having found actually a counter for the figure four, I'm going to be watching the man very closely.
Well, last week you had him dead and then he reversed it. So it shows that he and Bob Roop have really been talking it over. So you'll really have to watch him from now on in every match, not only you, but a lot of other opponents. And he comes up, a high-flying, full ring-length dropkick by Bob Orton Jr.
Orton showing a great deal of teamwork. Almost had the three count.
Almost had it.
They're keeping Zapata in the ring, not letting him get his fresh partner in, burning down. Oh, Zapata drags
out.
Now
the monk.
The monk comes in.
The monk comes in with a double drop.
Paul Orndorf, another man, very hard to go toe-to-toe with.
And the knee lift. Down goes the monk.
Like him or dislike him, he's a very talented athlete, very aggressive in that ring.
Both of them out.
Back of the head of the monk.
Orton in legally, and Arndorf staying in long enough to hold the monk.
What's this? Is this Boyd?
And using the rules right down to the limit of the law, Ted.
Well, that could be it right there. What's this? Orndorf going for the... He's with a figure four leg lock. He's using the figure four leg lock on the monk.
Same old right on you. You was able to reverse it. Hold on, but the monk is not you, and he cannot own it. Cannot break it, and Paul Arndorf using the figure four gains a victory for he and his partner Bob Orton Jr. in tag team action. We'll be back. Mike George versus Bob Roop after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 250 pounds from Blacksburg, Virginia, Bob Roop. And in the blue corner, at 265 pounds from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike George.
Action continues. Bob Roop, red, white, and blue versus one half of the Mid-South Tag Team Champions. Mike George, this should really be a battle, Ted.
Certainly should, Boyd, and without a doubt, you know that I'm going to be watching this very closely. Anytime that I have an opportunity to watch Bob Roop, I'm going to. He's a man that I've got to keep my eye on at all times. Mike George, another competitor, very fine competitor, former North American heavyweight champion. Two men in there with a great deal of determination. This should be one rugged contest. Mike George on top. Roop into the ropes.
Side headlock now. Mike George, that muscular arm, left arm around the head of Bob Roop. Roop, as we've told you, his qualifications, a great amateur, former WAU, going into a full Nelson now. Former North American heavyweight champion now applying the full Nelson to Mike George, and he breaks it.
Mike George demonstrating some of that power that he has. I would have to say that pound for pound that Mike George is probably a more powerful man than Roop, but Roop a very, very crafty individual, a very, very smart wrestler, a thinker in that ring all the time.
Ramming the face in the first time, but George
Buford blocking
it.
Mike using a little bit of smarts of his own there, Boyd.
And Roop blocks it.
Slips him behind. This could be a three. No, he two count and he's out. Very smart maneuver by Mike George.
George, one half of the Mid-South Tag Team title, sharing it with the Junkyard Dog, who also now doubles up as the Louisiana heavyweight champion. So the Junkyard Dog, who is a double title holder, really be marked, man.
Bob Roop had to, going up that second rope, going to come off on George and saw that big five cocked back there and decided, wait a minute, I better think about this a minute. And very smartly so. I've battled both of these men, Boyd, and both of them are very determined competitors.
Exchanging over at the far side.
Alex, is that the way you want to play it? I'll play your game.
And Roop now wants a few moments of respite as he's over in the far corner. But the referee, Alfred Neely, starting the counts.
I find it's very dangerous to give Roop time to think, Boyd, because he's a very, very crafty individual. He's always thinking in that ring, regardless of whether I like him or not, and I don't. You have to give credit where his credit's due. And the man is an intelligent wrestler.
Into the ropes, Alfred Neely. Break it up.
Got a handful of hair. Raking his eyes along that top rope.
On the steel cable of the top rope, Bob Roop.
Again, raking the eyes of Mike George along that rope.
Bob Roop going any way he can to get his hand raised in victory. Really using some cruel tactics on Mike George.
That's the thing right there, boy, that disgusts me about the man. He's a capable wrestler, has a lot of wrestling skills, yet when things aren't going his way, has no bones about digging into that bag of tricks and doing every underhand thing he can do to try and win. That hair again runs us into that turnbuckle. Mike reversing the pressure. That front face lock. Into his eyes. Mike coming on strong. One thing you always say about Mike, Boyd, if you want to fight, he'll fight you. His powerhouse rights. Every one of them landing to the side of the jaw, Bob Roop. Now he's going to rake his eyes along those ropes. What's good for, is good for the goose, is good for the gander. Roop again, retreating to that corner, begging off for a little time. This time, Mike not giving him that time. Not going to give him time to think.
Bob
got him down in that corner.
And Mike George retaliating, giving him back everything that he received. Bandit ringside, and listen at him, solidly behind Mike George.
Big time backdrop by Mike George. Finish it all. I've seen him beat many men with that move. Roop kicks out.
Two count, Alfred Neely signifying. One. Second shy of the shoulder.
Mike, stand on that back. Weaken that back. Stand on that back. They go for it again. Oh! Bob Roop hangs onto the rope. He was going for that shoulder breaker. He held the ropes back up. Big drop kick by Mike George. Another big drop kick by Mike George. This could be it again. Kicks out. Kicked out, and Mike takes it all the way to the floor. Both men staggered. Going for the flying head scissors. Mike brings him out of the apron. Staggers with a big powerhouse. Right in his shoulder, right into that post.
The metal ring post on the far side.
That had to hurt, Boyd. That had to hurt. Mike George is holding on to that right arm, obviously in a great deal of pain. Got a 10 count to get back in the ring.
The cement floor and was headed back in.
He's weakened that arm. But he's still game, Boyd.
He's using
still got a lot of fight left in him. Notice he's not using that right arm. That right arm's been weakened. Mike George of being a right-armed man. That puts him at a slight disadvantage, but it seems to be at no disadvantage now. Whoa. Tried to run him off. Didn't have that right arm to use. Oh, big high knee. This might be it, Boyd.
Bob Root. The victor over a game, Mike George, after he really hurt that left right arm. And we'll be back after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 280 pounds, from New York City, the Polish Prince, Ed Wiskowski. And in the blue corner, at 250 pounds, from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike Bond.
Two big men in the ring now, Ted DiBiase. It's Ed Wiskowski, the Polish Prince, against Mike Bond. Jack Howe, the referee.
Ed Wiskowski, another very big man. Fast making a name for himself here in the Mid-South. Big man, powerful man, and showing a little bit of agility there, too. And another one that has no bones about breaking the rules. Taking a fight right to this young man right now.
The body slam by Ed Wiskowski. In the opening moment, showing Mike Bond everything with his hands, feet, knees.
Just one word about that last match, Boyd. I made the comment that Bob Roop was a very smart thinker in the ring when he saw that that Mike George had injured that right arm. He took full advantage of it. Mike tried to push him off into that corner, run his head into that corner. Didn't have full use of his right arm, couldn't use that right arm. Roop immediately took advantage of that, pushed him off into the corner, hit him with that high knee and scored a fall. Also like to say that Paul Orndorff surprised me today, Boyd. After all this time of calling my fingers a leg lock, an illegal hold has seemed fit to use it to his own advantage. You can quick fall by the Polish Prince.
The Polish Prince, Ed Wiskowski, hand raised in victory over Mike Bond. We'll be back. Frank Monty versus General Skandor Akbar's Iron Sheik after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
Earlier in this program, you saw an interview with Precious Paul Ellering, who is just returning after 6 months out with an injury. Precious Paul Ellering wishes to accept the challenge that has been issued by General Skandor Akbar and the Iron Sheik pertaining to the Persian clubs. Now, as you recall, the challenge was that the Iron Sheik could do twice as many repetitions with the clubs as any other professional athlete. If he could not double the number of repetitions that any other athlete could do, then he would forfeit $1,000. Precious Paul Ellering thinks that he can do just that. So before we go into this next event, Precious Paul Ellering wishes to accept that challenge. So let's just see if he can indeed do as many repetitions as the Iron Sheik. And he's getting all set, primed for this event.
Ted, there's Paul Ellering now with a challenge. Remember, whatever he does with the Persian clubs, the Iron Sheik will have to do twice that many or pay him $1,000.
So, boy, I've certainly been looking forward to seeing this all night. I'm looking forward to seeing anybody
take
on this challenge.
4, 5, 6.
Look at him. Oh,
he's going with it too,
look at the fans
10,
are going wild
11,
here.
12, 13,
also,
14,
the Iron
15,
Sheik and
16,
Skandor Akbar
18,
are stirred
19,
up. Look at his hands on his hips, the General Akbar. He can't believe it.
23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50. 50 repetitions. How about that now?
I don't know how many.
That means
but
that
a lot
if the
of
Iron
them,
Sheik cannot do 100, he will forfeit that $1,000.
We've got a wrestling match. We're still in the wrestling business, you know, with Frank Monte. But we'll do it after we beat Frank Monte. And I'll even up the bounty. $2,000 and maybe 200 more repetitions. But first things first, Frank Monte.
Very well, you heard it. He will accept this challenge after this event. And this event is for one fall or remaining television time in the red corner at 260 pounds from Tehran, Iran, the Iron Sheik. And in the blue corner at 234 pounds from Seattle, Washington, Frank Monte.
The introduction, Frank Monte against the Iron Sheik, but here, DiBiase, from our position away from the ring, we couldn't hear it, but it seemed like instead of the Iron Sheik going ahead and beating him by doing twice as many Akbar then stepped in and said they must have the match. So what'd you say? You say it he's stalling?
Seems to me, Boyd, that maybe the Akbar is just a little bit concerned as to whether the Sheik can go ahead and meet the challenge of Paul Ellering. But then again, on the other hand, you know, I don't think that he'd stall for time now. I mean, I would think that the Sheik is going to go ahead and do his best, you know, not to let time run out, but to beat this man, because at this point, he can't stand to have a draw on his hands.
Ted, I just stepped over to ring announcer Reese Bowden as he left the ring, and he said Paul Ellering did 50. 50 of them with the Persian club. That means the Iron Sheik would have to do 100 or lose $1,000.
Paul Ellering showed a great amount of skill in handling those Persian clubs.
And now it's wrestling in the ring, and the strength of the Iron Sheik around the body of Frank Monte.
What I'd have to say, I'd like to see this match in one way or the other, because I want to see if that Iron Sheik can double Paul Ellering's 50.
Especially he'll have to do 100 of them. That's a lot of them. Those clubs are about 75 pounds, Ted, as you and I both know. And 100 of them really would be something.
Right now, Frank Monte holding his own with the Iron Sheik. Maybe the Iron Sheik a little bit upset over what he just saw. Oh, he's got him that suplex. That's it, Boyd, right there. It's got to be it. Three count.
There's the winner of the wrestling match, the Iron Sheik over Frank Monte. There you see Reese Bowden and precious Paul Ellering in the ring now.
All right, now we will continue with that Persian club feat. As you heard a few minutes ago,
this man has just had a grueling match with an international star. Is this American justice? Is this American fair play?
Well, you can't remind you, Teddy Gossie. So now, what do you think? Do you think Akbar is stalling
you
now?
You cannot ask this man.
I feel like Akbar may be a little bit
concerned
as to whether his man can,
after a grueling match,
can answer the challenge
star.
Now.
Don't get the idea. I'm worried.
He looks
don't
a little bit
worried.
Don't you
dare
get
me, the boy. Idea that
well,
I'm worried.
I have to do 100 of them. I'll lose
$1,000. Because I know my man can do a multitude more than precious Paul Ellering. And as I said, I'll even up $2,000. I don't care.
I think he's stalling,
but you can't ask him to do it now. Not now. He just had
he promised he'd just do it
had
right after they had the match out of the way. But
Paul Ellering calling for the people. He wants to see him do it.
Can 30 seconds, everybody is waiting, but I believe you're right, Ted DiBiase. He's stalling, but I'll tell you something. General Skandar Akbar and you folks at home, knowing Grizzly Smith, the matchmaker that I've known for many years, we tell you like it is, the Iron Sheik will have to answer the challenge and do double the amount that Paul Ellering did next week. If I know Grizzly Smith, he'll have to do it. All our time's gone. Next week it'll also be Brian Blair against Paul Orndorff. Goodbye, everybody, for Boyd Pierce and Ted DiBiase. Everybody, and welcome. welcome to this edition of Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. I'm Boyd Pierce, your host, and I'm telling you we have a tremendous card this week, but want to tell you the continuance of the $1,000 Persian Club contest between Precious Paul Ellering and the Iron Sheik. Ted DiBiase, the North American Heavyweight Champion, will wrestle. Bob Roop and Bob Orton Jr. will be in a tag team match. Brian Blair takes on Paul Orndorff. And the dream match, you have just 2 weeks left to send in that dream match, the match that you, the fans, want to make. Send it to the television station in which you're watching this week's program. They'll forward it on to us. And the match with the largest number of votes will be the match you'll see the first week of taping in January. Remember, the American Dream Dusty Rhodes will be in the area. Andre the Giant, Offense Seeker, the Samoan Warriors will be coming off of their suspension. Ted DiBiase, you name it, send it to us. Our guest commentator of the week, always the expert, whether it's in the ring or out of the ring, the Oklahoma Stampeder, Cowboy Bill Watts.
Well, I guess, Boyd, what you mean is I always have an opinion. It doesn't mean it's always right, and probably a lot of times it's wrong, but certainly I'm going to voice it. And, of course, things are hot and heavy as 1981 rolls down and 1982 gets ready to kick off. And only two more weeks, like you said, and I was talking to Grizzly Smith, and the mail has been really heavy, and some of the matches really show that the fans, there's certain things they want, and this is the one time in 2 weeks they're going to get to be in Grizzly's shoes and make the match, and it should be an exciting thing. Like you said, with Andre the Giant and Dusty Rhodes, we have some exciting news about Dusty Rhodes, a great thing for Mid-South sports. And so without any further, let's get to the matches in the ring.
Right. Opening introduction, Reacher Bowden.
And it's tag team action for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 275 pounds from Eastern Europe, Jerry Novak. And his partner at 228 pounds from Alexandria, Louisiana, Ricky Ferrara. In the blue corner at 265 pounds from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike George. And his partner at 235 pounds, Carlos Zapata.
Our first event to start off this week's action, tag team match, Jerry Novak and Rick Ferreira versus Carlos Zapata and Mike George from St. Joseph, Missouri. Alfred Neely calls one man from each team. It's Rick Ferreira and Mike George. Here's Bill Watts.
Well, this wasn't originally signed to be this way. Mike George is not teamed with anybody except the Junkyard Dog. But the dog's been having some knee problems. No thanks to a couple of the opponents he's had in recent matches. You know, whenever you get titles like the dog has, all of a sudden he's got one half of the Mid-South tag title along with Mike George. And then he beat the Great Kabuki in New Orleans for the Louisiana title. It's almost like you become a magnet. You start really attracting the action, and Dog was attracting all the action and was the real center of all the pressure to start with. Now with those titles, he's in a pressure cooker. And of course, Mike George is teamed with Zapata. He didn't want to cancel the match. He wanted to go on with it, so he's out there against Rick Ferrara and Big Jerry Novak. Mike George, who was very courageous in a tremendous main event here last week against Bob Roop. You know, the credibility of the match because of the tremendous competition just shows what an awesome contender Bob Roop is. He's also an opportunist. Novak stepping in. He's a big, huge man. And of course, Mike George with Zapata as his partner. Zapata is an unknown, but certainly he doesn't have the class as far as the wrestling on Mid-South to really become a backup man for Mike George. You know, you need to know who's on the other side. That's not taking anything away from Zapata, but there's just a tremendous difference. And so, and Mike, it's an unknown, and it's really like being out there on your own. And right now, Rick Ferrara and Jerry Novak have Mike tied in the ropes and are really taking it to him. They're really hammering him. Of course, the referee, they're both on him, and Zapata being the unknown, he sure hasn't come to help him out. That's the one thing you miss. If the dog was there, he'd never let him gang up like that. Looked like Zapata's finally said at least sticking his nose in there to try to help out, but he was short work with Big Jerry Novak just throwing him out. Mike George in a lot of trouble right now. Mike George is fighting back. He knows he can only count on one thing in this match with it. Is that counting on his own power, and Ricky Ferrara came out and he slams Zapata on that concrete floor. So Mike George is on his own against two people. But Mike pulled one out of the old bag of tricks right there, and he saved himself Drop kick by Mike George. Mike George showing what it's made out of. Former North American champion. Referee Alfred Neely counting the foul.
Mike George doing his best when he's against two men in the ring, getting the victory for he and Carlos Zapata. We'll be back after this word from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
Boyd Pierce last week marked the return to the ring wars of one of the most colorful, self-styled individuals wrestling's ever seen, the precious one, Paul Ellering, coming off a six-month knee injury where he'd had to have really intricate surgery. But Paul Ellering being the guy he is, he worked out constantly, and he doesn't look like he lost any form. And he stepped right back into the thick of things, saying he challenged the Iron Sheik and the Persian clubs. And of course, everybody knows Paul is a very fit man, and it looks like he's mastered the Persian clubs. And last week, everybody was for Paul Ellering as he did 50 repetitions with the Persian clubs. Let's relive that moment right now.
Earlier in this program, you saw an interview with precious Paul Ellering, who is just returning after 6 months out with an injury. Precious Paul Ellering wishes to accept the challenge that has been issued by General Skandor Akbar and the Iron Sheik pertaining to the Persian clubs. Now, as you recall, the challenge was that the Iron Sheik could do twice as many repetitions with the clubs as any other professional athlete. If he could not double the number of repetitions that any other athlete could do, then he would forfeit $1,000. Precious Paul Ellering thinks that he can do just that. So before we go into this next event, Precious Paul Ellering wishes to accept that challenge. So let's just see if he can indeed do as many repetitions as the Iron Sheik. And he's getting all set, primed for this event.
Ted, there's Paul Ellering now with a challenge. Remember, whatever he does with the Persian clubs, the Iron Sheik will have to do twice that many or pay him $1,000.
Boy, I've certainly been looking forward to seeing this all night. I'm looking forward to seeing anybody
take on this challenge. 4, 5, 6. Seven.
Look at him. Oh,
he's going with it too.
Look at the fans are going wild
11,
here.
12, 13,
also,
14,
the Iron Sheik at Skandor Akbar.
18,
are stirred 18, up. Look at his hands on his hips, the General Akbar. He can't believe it.
24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39. 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50. 50 repetitions. How about that now?
I don't know how many.
That means
but
that
a lot
if the
of
Iron
them,
Sheik
look,
cannot do 100, he will forfeit that $1,000.
We've got a wrestling match. We're still in the wrestling business, you know, with Brank Money. But we'll do it after we beat Brank Money. And I'll even up the bounty, $2,000, and maybe 200 more repetitions. But first things first, Brank Money.
Very well, you heard it. He will accept this challenge after this event.
And of course, the rest is history. The Sheik did beat Brank Money, but then this General Skandor Akbar apparently is not as confident of the Sheik's ability to do double the number of 100 repetitions with the Persian clubs, and he actually stalled out the remaining time, as you so avidly pointed out. But you're right, Grizzly Smith did book it back here and said the challenge has been issued. He's done 50 reps, so the Sheik has 100 reps to do, and they're in the ring waiting to finish the challenge for $1,000, which Akbar has personally doubled to $2,000. Let's see what happens. Let's go to the ring.
Last week right here, you saw Precious Paul Ellering take up the challenge of the Iron Sheik on the Iranian club exercise, and he did.
Let it never be known that the general is a wheelchair. As promised, we'll show you what a real man can do with the Persian clubs.
Well, Precious Paul Ellering did 50 repetitions, so now it's up to the Iron Sheik to do 100 or more. So count along with me, fans, and let's see if the Iron Sheik can do that. set now, and here he goes. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 2, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 7, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 5, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 3, 4, 5, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 9, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 5, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 6, 97, 98, 99, 100, 102, 1. And he did. He did over 100. He did 103. So there you have it. Precious Paul Ellering has been defeated with that Persian club exercise.
You know something, Reeser? Last week, Precious Paul did 50, right?
Right.
And this is this week, right?
Right.
And Precious Paul has made a lot of people happy in a week, right?
Well, I don't know now.
Can you dig it, though?
The Sheik did 103.
All right. Last week was last week. This week is this week. Precious Paul wants to do them again this week.
Well, that would be up to General Skandor Akbar to...
Let's hear what Blender Brain has to say.
Well, there you have it. He's issued another challenge.
He's mad enough. It's all right with me.
Okay. Let's see how many you can do this week. He did 103.
And Precious Paul, for 444 days, I had to drink 444 glasses of water. I had to dance with 444 girls, and I had to listen to tie a yellow ribbon around the old oak tree 444 times. I just may go for that.
Well, let's see if Precious Paul can do 444 repetitions. Count along with me, and let's see how many he can do. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52.
Boy, Pierce, the Iron Sheik had just broke in as Paul Ellering was going up over the bark, which was gonna force him to have to do over 100. And the Iron Sheik has just Pearl Harbored the Precious One. It's about the same type of tactics as the Khomeini and the embassy. Without warning, they struck a defenseless person at the time. The crowd is shouting, USA, USA. The Sheik puts a camel clutch on Precious Ellering with Akbar in there with the flag. Jack Howe tried to come to the aid, thrown out of the floor. The Sheik's got the Precious One at his mercy. Of course, Paul Ellering is a man of no allegiance, so he's in there alone. Ellering's coming up, powering himself up. He's behind the Sheik's leg. Ellering got out of the camel clutch.
using that tremendous strength even after all those repetitions with the heavy Persian clubs. The Sheik is firing on him. Ellering is firing away. Ellering's taking control. Body slam. Elbow. Akbar really. Akbar just drove that flagstaff right into the abdominal section. Now he's belaboring the precious one with the flag, the Iranian flagstaff. Matchmaker Grizzly Smith ought to get another referee out there. Souffle. Precious Paul Ellering, a man alone. Reliving history right here. Alfred Neely, another referee in the ring. Akbar finally seemingly letting the Sheik vent his vengeance and has pulled the Sheik out. Ellering, a man.
While things simmer down, we try to get it under control. We'll be right back after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit in the red corner. At 248 pounds from Tampa, Florida, Paul Orndorff. And in the blue corner at 232 pounds, also from Tampa, Florida, Brian Blair.
Action continuing now. Two top grapplers, both men. Hailing from the state of Florida, Brian Blair versus Paul Orndorff.
That's right, of course, the crowd is still a little upset about the treatment of the precious Paul Ellering at the hands of Khomeini's former personal bodyguard, the Iron Sheik, and the General Skandar Akbar. Ellering is the man alone out there. So the contest with the Persian clubs remains unresolved at this point. It was not an official match. So I don't think Grizzly Smith can sanction a fine. And we're right back with a dogfight with Brian Blair and Paul Orndorff. Blair, known to have capability of using the figure four leg lock. I don't know if he has enough skill perfected, enough technique perfected to get it on the likes of Paul Orndorff, former North American champion. I noticed Bob Roop is out there looking on closely, and Bob Roop is the man that's been coaching Paul Orndorff in breaking Ted DiBiase's figure four leg lock. And also from what I heard last week, Paul Orndorff used the figure four leg lock himself. And of course it only stands to reason, Boyd, that if you know how to break a hold, you know how to apply it, because you've got to first study it from the angle of applying it so you can find out if it does have a weakness. And of course 2 weeks ago, we had a time limit draw Ted DiBiase having his figure four reversed. Paul Orndorff reversed it on him, and DiBiase held on with such courage. All our hearts went out to him and did not submit in it, which could have a tremendous implication on the North American title. Brian Blair played football at Louisville while Paul Orndorff was one of the great running backs at the University of Tampa. A lot of personal pride at stake here, a personal rivalry. Paul Orndorff. You know, when the dog and Mike George beat off Nsika, I think they probably thought they'd handle it all. And Paul Orndorff and Terry Orndorff and Bob Orton Jr. and Bob Roop have created a completely different type of threat, a threat that's got its subtleties, a threat that has some real treachery in their technique. They're not the awesome, brutal power like the Samoans. It's more the sly, the mental hassle that they created with Terry Orndorff and the yellow mask and the ability to shift identities under that mask. So certainly the dog and Mike George's Mid-South tag titles aren't safe as long as Paul Orndorff and Bob Orton Jr. are teamed up, and Ted DiBiase has to watch his every step. With Orndorff, former North American champion, frothing at the bit, and the other one, maybe the most devious and devastating of them all, Bob Roode. Orndorff used a legal form to drive young Brian Blair off. Brian Blair went for a move, but Orndorff was so quick that there Brian Blair showed speed and agility and quickness of his own. As these men battle, what a feather in his cap if Brian Blair could defeat the former North American champion right here on TV. Ted DiBiase coming up next. Bob Roode, Bob Orton Jr. in a tag. Ed Wiskowski, the Iron Sheik, scheduled later to wrestle Don Serrano, a man who shows that he is without a doubt has no mercy and no heart, the Iron Sheik. Next week, we're going to show you a tremendous 1981 highlight film, a lot of the exciting action that's taken place. Remember, only 2 more weeks for the Dream Match, so be sure to write the station you're viewing now, your cards, your letters, specify Dream Match Wrestling in care of this station. It'll be forwarded to us, and Grizzly Smith will tally them. It's your chance to sit in the matchmaker's seat. And what an array of talent Grizzly Smith has lined up to see which way you, the fan, wants to match him. Real skill and technique out there. Finely conditioned men. My boy Pierce, thinking back, the Sheik looked like that 102 or 3 reps he did was about all he could handle. And if Ellering had done, say, 60 or 70 repetitions, and he was flowing along there pretty good, it would have forced the Sheik to have to do 120 or 140. It might have cost the general $2,000. So they use their treachery to get out of that monetary loss. Beautiful move out there. Oh, and a great move again on Paul Orndorff. This shows why you can never underestimate him, and he's certainly taking credit for it, showing us by pointing to his head that he was thinking ahead of Brian Blair. But Brian Blair was also staying right in with him, Orndorff punishing him. Well, the competition, it's really a fine line between the top guys as to who wins or loses a match on any given day. You know, it's like two top NFL football teams. It's just a fine line. It could be the attitude, the momentum, so many factors. But one thing about it, you never know what will happen between two great opponents here in the South. High knee by Orndorff. Looks like he's got young Brian Blair in a tremendous amount of trouble. Great heart, this Brian Blair, though. I'll tell you, the only way to beat him is to stick his shoulders that canvas for that three count. There he is, Brian Blair fighting back on Orndorff. Like I said before, there's an intense rivalry. There always was between these two young guys who both wanted to be the top dog in the state of Florida. And Brian Blair is showing that he can fight with a little tenacity too. Of course, Orndorff then raked the eyes. Power slam by Orndorff, his patented move. And Orndorff's going for the figure four. Going for the figure four. Brian Blair kicked him off. Brian Blair kicked him off. He knows the defense, for the best defense for the figure four is to stop it before the man locks it. Orndorff going for the standing suplex. But Brian Blair kicked his legs. Orndorff, Blair suplexed Orndorff. Brian Blair just reversed the hole and suplexed Orndorff. And the crowd is really with him, and Brian Blair knows what he's done. And there he goes. Brian Blair putting the figure four. He's just locked up Paul Orndorff in the figure four. And Bob Roode is screaming and motioning and coaching Paul Orndorff. Paul Orndorff in a lot of trouble. There he goes for that reverse like he did 2 weeks ago here with Ted DiBiase, the North American champion. If Orndorff reverses it, it reverses the pain and the pressure. It's almost like the Indian deathlock. Now you can see Brian Blair starting to get that excruciating pain. Alfred Neely is asking him if Blair won't capitulate. Blair won't submit. He's saying no. But how far can he go? We thought that 2 weeks ago that Orndorff would break the legs of Ted DiBiase, and DiBiase is probably 20 or 25 pounds bigger than Brian Blair. Neely asking him. The referee's out. Jack House come out to sit Bob Roode back in his chair and make sure there's no interference. Neely's asking Brian Blair. Brian Blair won't give up. What a heart in this young man. But Orndorff's got it cranked in.
When you recall that DiBiase's match was the last match, television time remaining, DiBiase held on until time ran out.
Now, Fernini called for the bell, Bill.
Neely's called for the bell. I didn't.
Well, you see Brian Blair saying that he did not give up.
The people are saying no. The people are saying no. But Paul Orndorff won't break the hold. He won't break the hold, and Brian Blair's in excruciating pain. Jack Howe telling Bob Roop to go to his seat. We'll have to get the referee's decision from here.
Now you see Alfred Nina conferring with Jack Howe.
Maybe we'll wave at Jack Howe. Maybe we can get Jack Howe over here, Boyd and Esther.
Jack, the ruling, please.
Boyd, the referee would like to make it plain that Brian Blair did not give up in this particular instance. He was afraid of further injury to Brian and therefore called the match himself.
There you have it, Bill. Brian Blair did not give up, but referee using his own discretion.
It's a judgment call, and I got to say, it's sad for Brian Blair, but from the position of things and the amount of time remaining, I'm saying they made the right call.
And he could have saved that leg. We'll be back. The North American Heavyweight Champion Ted DiBiase in action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 232 pounds from San Diego, California, Mike Boyer. And in the blue corner at 252 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska, the North American Heavyweight Champion, Ted DiBiase.
Mid-South Wrestling, Mike Boyer taking on North American Heavyweight title holder, Ted DiBiase. Jack Howe calls for the bell.
I want to say one thing during the commercial break. One of the first people to young Brian Blair to see about him was Ted DiBiase, because I'm sure that he could relate better to the pain Brian Blair was in than any of us. Brian Blair, a courageous man. He never did give up. Referee's decision, a judgment call. I have to say that in essence of the time left and the position Brian Blair was in, that it was a proper call. Of course, Brian Blair, having a fighting spirit, hated to have the match go in a record book, but it is a win for Paul Orndorff, and as Orndorff was leaving, he was hollering, "What? Look at that, DiBiase, look at that." Ted DiBiase has to now wonder, with a man having a way of countering his famous figure four leg lock, you know, that's like having a home run ball. Anytime you're in trouble, you had that knockout punch or that home run situation or that breakaway touchdown in that figure four leg lock, and now somebody has come along with a method of neutralizing it. Ted DiBiase has to feel that it could put the North American title in severe jeopardy. And I wonder who is jeopardizing it most, Boyd Pierce. Paul Orndorff, the man that's doing it, or the man that's sitting by, that's devised the counter, the man who is coaching Orndorff, Bob Roop, a man who's shown his treachery and his, but also his tenaciousness and his toughness and his ability to be quite an opportunist and strike at any weakness or any time that an opponent is in a jeopardy position. Maybe he's laying back and let DiBiase and Orndorff tear each other's legs down, and he can walk in and capitalize. So it all it gets really into the chess part or the mental part, the part that Ernie Ladd was so adept at doing and putting the pressure on the opponent. Some great moves out here between Mike Boyer and the North American champion Ted DiBiase. Mentioning Ernie Ladd, I'm sure he's chafing at the bit for the Samoans, Afonseca, for the suspension to be lifted January 1. We haven't heard, according to Grizzly Smith, from them. We don't know if they're going to return to Mid-South. We don't know if they return to Mid-South, if Ernie Ladd will be their financial advisor. Ernie Ladd has lost his meal ticket. Of course, his meal ticket, as he says, has always been himself, 6'9", 320, and he certainly is capable. But he's kind of made a low profile recently. Wow, they're sounding off out there as they trade leather. DiBiase with that tremendous range and height. Boyette comes up. DiBiase cuts him a high drop kick. I'm sure he's got a ton of incentive right now, and that's a fired up man. Power slam. And DiBiase still going for that figure four. Roop. Bob Orton Jr. closely monitoring it from the balcony of their dressing room area.
And they don't have to teach Ted DiBiase how to use the figure four. He's the master of it, and it gains him another victory. We'll be back with tag team action when we return after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
It's tag team action now for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 250 pounds from Blacksburg, Virginia, Bob Roop. And his partner at 238 pounds from Kansas City, Kansas, the Mississippi heavyweight champion, Bob Orton Jr. In the blue corner at 250 pounds from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike Bond. And his partner at 234 pounds from Seattle, Washington, Frank Monty.
Big team action now. The cheers for Big Mike Bond and his partner Frank Monty, and the jeers and boos for the rugged duo of Bob Roop and Bob Orton Jr.
Boy, Pierce, you have a former Louisiana champion out there in Roop. You have the current Mississippi heavyweight champion in Orton Jr. So, Orton Jr.'s been kind of a subtle Mississippi champion in that he has defeated anybody he's defended the title against. He's also been involved in a lot of tag matches. He's kind of a catalyst. The man kind of sneaks up on you. He's got that height and that range, that tendon strength, and he's a tremendous athlete. And I think a lot of people that have looked at him at first at the Mississippi title holder were underestimating him because he's always in the thick of the action. Mike Bond's got him down for a predicament. Orton bridges out. Ralph Neely having to scramble, and that's the hard part about refereeing one of these tag matches. So many people to stay out of their way. I'll say one thing, Ted DiBiase got a lot of courage. He went right back to that figure four. He's got a lot of faith in him. I don't think he feels that Orndorff or anybody else can reverse it on him again. He sure showed a lot of finesse and power and confidence as he put it on Mike Boyer and made him say uncle. Bob Roop, a man who showed what an awesome and methodical and well-schooled and skills and techniques he has as he took the measure of Mike Jordan, former Mississippi champion, and one half of the Mid-South Tag Team champion here last week on Mid-South Wrestling. And Frank Monty is showing that, my gosh, he's not going to sit back and wait. He's going to take it to him. And the crowd shows their appreciation. We'll have Dusty Rhodes here on Mid-South Wrestling and some of the highlights about him and Kabuki next week. Body slam. Frank Monty. Bob Roop going up like to come off, but Mike Bond runs him down and runs him away. But as the referee was distracted, it shows you what teamwork that Roop is seemingly always the center of. And that the reason I say Orton's a catalyst because he flows with the motion or whatever. And they use it to double clothesline Frank Monty and take the momentum right away from the Monty and the Bond team.
Bob Roop back in now.
Right, and he is flat taking charge. That's what I mean. This man will find a way of disabling his opponent. Monty, an inside cradle, but in behind him was a tag was made with Bob Orton, and I don't believe Bob Roop is holding Monty where Monty can't get released, and he tagged behind, a legal tag, and he held Frank Monty, and Bob Orton Jr. just guillotined him with that high leg drop. Shows that these men have been a team on some of the occasion, some of the place with that talent and teamwork they have. It doesn't come together all at once like that. Big Mike Bond's in trying to really get after Bob Orton Jr. He body slams Orton, body slams Roop. Side headlock. Orton had driven Monty out on the floor. Crisscross, a tag is made again. And I'm sure Mike Bond didn't see the tag. The referee saw it. Roop is a legal man in the ring now. He's a legal man in the ring. Bond just did a roll-up, but he is not the legal man. Bob Orton is not the legal man. What Roop has just done is legal. It shows the caginess, the animal instinct, and the cunning of these people. Now another tag is made as Roop sets him up for the backbreaker, gives him the backbreaker. He's got a four count to break. On the three count, he back broke him and got out as Bob Orton Jr. delivered the coup de grace, and there he goes for his patented pile driver. Hard to overcome a team with this kind of skill. this type of teamwork. Makes me wonder, where have these guys teamed so much to get this type of timing?
Well, they took a rule book right down to the last letter of the law to the count, and it resulted in a victory. Bob Roop, Bob Orton Jr., we'll be back with more action after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 280 pounds from New York City, the Polish Prince, Ed Wiskowski. And in the blue corner at 240 pounds from Los Angeles, California, Tom Renesto Jr.
Now, Bill Watts, two big men in the ring dressed in black, Tom Renesto Jr., and across the way in the blue long tights with the red stars, the Polish Prince, Big Ed Wiskowski.
This match wastes no time. These guys are getting after it. It seems like the mood has been set today that it's dog-eat-dog out there. Of course, Wiskowski is an unknown, but he's an impressive man. You know, one of the matches that impressed me most was a loss in Wiskowski's record when he wrestled Ted DiBiase, the North American champion, and showed that he was, without a doubt, a main event wrestler, because that was a tough, tough match, and Ted DiBiase was glad to get out of there with a victory. And then, with that loss on his record, Wiskowski came right back the following week and took the measure of Jimmy Garvin, who is just about as tough a competitor as they come. And since then, he's just steamrolled a lot of opposition. And right now, he's really powering over Tom Renesto Jr. We got Don Serrano versus the Iron Sheik scheduled to go on. I know how upset the fans are, and they try to blame the referee with the tag situation that went on before us. But everything that Roop and Orton did was, well, as you said, within the limit. It was skimming the limit of the rule book, but it was legal, and the referee was helpless. Let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, if you get in that ring and you got to have that referee to bail you out, you don't have any business in that ring. I mean, you know, there's a lot of times and a lot of matches I've been in where I thought I got maybe a raw deal by a referee. But if I sat down and started blaming my losses on the referee, then I should blame my wins on him too. And that would certainly show that I didn't have any ability and didn't belong out there. So I always just took it with a grain of salt and said, hey, that's the business you're competing in. It's a professional sport. They're not always going to make the calls to make you happy. And you better not get sad or get your dauber down over it. You better get out there and battle, because you've got to win it yourself, so you lose it yourself. Atomic drop by Wiskowski. Boy, he just dropped right in on Renesto. And Renesto doesn't look like he's got any gas left. Wiskowski is just pretty well flat taking it out. He was outgunned from the start. Wiskowski with his side backbreaker. There we go.
1, 2, 3. That's the reason they call him the Polish Prince. The victory goes to Big Ed Wiskowski. We'll be back. Don Serrano versus the Iron Sheik after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at 260 pounds from Tehran, Iran, the Iron Sheik.
Now Petita calls for the bell. The introduction not finished. Don Serrano, the Iron Sheik. Billy never got the introduction.
Yeah, I don't know why Alvardini had called for the bell, because there was never an announcement finished. The Sheik is going out. I guess he really feels confident after the way he treated Paul Ellering. And he's blasting Don Serrano. Throwing him out. That's Precious Paul Ellering. Precious Paul Ellering is going to do a little dishing out. That he was on the receiving end, and Akbar is a little bit upset. I'm sure Ellering doesn't care whether there's a disqualification or what. It's just work. Don't get mad. Get even.
Akbar is a whole lot upset. There went the turban. He's moving.
Precious Paul Ellering. He's coming to dish it out. He says that they can pearl over him. And the crowd, who was kind of thinning out because they didn't think Don Serrano had much of a chance, the ones that stayed got an unexpected treat. Kind of like people filing out in a football game and then turning around and you're wondering in the parking lot, why all the reaction?
There's
1 minute of airtime left, and Paul Ellering is really pounding it. Referee should make the disqualification off this. Akbar's pulling his man out of there. Akbar's driven the Sheik out. He's pulled the Sheik out, and they've turned tail and they've run, Boyd Pierce.
Leaving Ellering in the ring. Now, ladies and gentlemen, remember next week the special 1981 highlight show. And in 2 weeks, the eighth one of the world, Andre the Giant, plus the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And we'll find out whether Oppenzig and the Samoan Warriors will return after the suspension. If they do, will Ernie Ladd be their manager? We'll find out in 2 weeks. Till then, Lloyd Pierce for our guest commentator, Bill Watson. Goodbye, everybody, for Mid-South Wrestling.